I think we are in for a little bit more speculation because some of these decisions and some of these negotiations are as hard as they look, regardless of, you know, the kind of front that you will see, you know, in front of cameras. Mm-hmm. They are as hard as they look. And the fact that it has not come to pass, it's not due to lack of trying. But like I have said, it is not true to say that because there is no presidential candidate, mm-hmm. that it is necessarily a disadvantage, okay? And that those people who have a presidential candidate are necessarily advantaged. Mm-hmm. I don't think so. It is possible to make an argument that, and people who would like to speed it would say it is strategy. I don't think it is strategy, mm-hmm. but I don't necessarily think it's a disadvantage.
All right, and Ati, do you agree with the professor that this deal has nothing for the people?
Well, you know, first and foremost, the four guys want to share power. Mm-hmm. And of course, each one of them comes with a constituency, which is mostly tribal. Mm-hmm. So, the narrative created out there is that when one of your own has power, then you get all your problems evaporated.
Right.
Which is a lie, because I went to school in Central Province, Kiambu, to be precise, for my A-levels. And some of the poorest Kenyans
live there.
In fact, in Gatundu, they are very poor guys. Some of them don't even have where to bury their dead. Mm-hmm. We still have what they call a gishagi, the villages, in some of those places. Mm-hmm. There's a place in Nyeri. They got the titles for the gishagis the other day, after 54 years of independence. So the lie that when one of your own has power, then you all get, you go to Canaan. Mm-hmm. It's a very fat lie. But you know, Kenyans have been hoodwinked into believing that that is what it is. Mm-hmm. Of course, the clique around power is normally very small. Mm-hmm. But you know, they have, they control information. Mm-hmm. And they have made the masses believe that they are the ones who, they are the custodians of the community. So if they have power, everybody is in. And if you don't kowtow to their whims, they'll whip you into submission. Mm-hmm. So that is the reality. But now coming back to what the guys are looking at, they are trying to come up with a formula. Mm-hmm. Of course, trying to reenact 2002, that cannot work.
Mm-hmm. Because, why is that?
2002 was a transitional election. President Moi had just retired, mm-hmm. and Uhuru was brought in. And then there was a fallout in Kano, and the new Kano. Uh-huh. You know, Raila had disbanded his NDP and joined Kano and became the Secretary General. So he led an exodus after President Moi then picked Uhuru. Right now, there is no exodus from Jubilee. One. Mm-hmm. Two, this is not a transitional election. You have a sitting president who is defending his seat. So the circumstances in 2002 cannot be reenacted now. Maybe they try to reenact 2007. But you know, 2007, 41 against one refused to work. Uh-huh. So even now, of course, even 41 against one was a lie. Because PNU was not just, you know, some people who are not very informed think that the Kikuyus, Meru, Embu, and Bera are one tribe. Big lie, because those are four or five different communities. Mm-hmm. Each with, they could be closely related.
Yes, one would say yes, they come from more or less the same region.
Yeah, but coming from the same region does not make you one community. The Luyas and the Luos come from the same region.
They are not one.
The Kisi is also in that axis. So you can't say that because you come from one region, now that makes you one community.
Right.
It doesn't.
I mean, and so with this signing that is taking place today, are we expecting, what are you expecting, Prof?
That's a huge question. Mm-hmm. Because generally, I expect nothing from the political class. Mm-hmm. I like what Andati is saying, that it's an attempt to reinvent 2002. Mm-hmm. This country needs to get to a place where it is looking ahead.
Not looking back.
Uh-huh. And when you listen to the political class, and unfortunately, when you listen to the political class in the opposition, they are stuck somewhere in the past. And the things that you will hear them talking about, when they wanted to use unconstitutional means to remove the IEBC, they started talking, they started talking about IPPG. Some people who are adults now don't even know what IPPG, IPPG is. So if we do not have a new way of interpreting the future or charting a way for the future for the country and for the youth, there is nothing to expect from what they are going to announce apart from the effort that he has talked about to reinvent the past, which he says, one, the past that they're trying to reinvent is itself a narrative, and it cannot be reinvented because the circumstances have changed. And like I was saying, the challenges that they are having are real. And the challenges that they are having are that they don't have any new way of looking at this. Okay, so they keep on going back to MOUs that were broken. They keep on talking back to coalitions that didn't work. They keep on talking about what happened, who was with who, and who owes who, and who betrayed who. So I think this is another chapter in the political narrative of ethnic kingpins will are dealing to get deals for themselves.
And I mean, you know, Prof, you've spoken about this several times. You're very vocal about the fact that you don't see what is different between NASA and Jubilee and Dati. With whatever deal and whatever will be revealed at this meeting today, is NASA likely to come up with anything different, any issues different from Jubilee?
You know, the difference is Jubilee is a duopoly. Two tribes coming together and practicing the tribal chieftains of two tribes, practicing politics of exclusion. Now, the other ones now have come up with four of them. So they want now to come and so that we lock these ones out of power, so that we now eat. Because the whole issue is about, you know, even those who make noise about corruption and all that. When you look at the code counties, starting with Nairobi here, can you show me a single one which is working? Maybe Mutua to some extent, but Mutua has not been fully coded. The rest of them, name it. Nairobi, Kakamega, Turkana, Kakamega, Mombasa. There's nothing to show, you know? You know, when Kibaki was coming to power in 2002, our national budget was 52 billion. The entire country. Now, Nairobi, in the last 4 years, has received over 100 billion.
All right. And just before you continue, I understand Patrick Amimo is ready for us now at Lavington. Amimo, good morning. If you can hear me, what can you tell us about the proceedings of the meeting there this morning?
Thank you so much. Indeed, leaders have started trickling in. We've seen members of parliament coming in. We saw member of the management committee, James Orengo, has already checked in. Former Busia Senator Amos Wako has also checked in, among other political leaders from ODM, Wiper, and Ford Kenya. Today is the day when NASA will sign. There is a power sharing arrangement. It's another occasion in the country where we saw last year Jubilee Party collapsing 12 political parties to form Jubilee Party of Kenya. And this time around, we see the opposition trying to come up with a certain form of coalition arrangement ahead of the August 8th polls. With me here is the Chief Executive Officer of NASA, Secretariat Norman Magai, just to give us, to bring us up to speed. Probably, Mr. Magai, what will entail the signing of agreement? What are we, what are Kenyans expected to see on this particular day, this morning?
I think today is a defining moment because it marks the beginning of the formation of government by the National Super Alliance. And what we are doing today is the document being signed is a framework of our plan of action for the country. It does not just contain clauses on sharing of power. What it contains is our foundational principles on how we want to deal with our economy, on how we want to deal with the management of the public debt, and how we want to revamp and take Kenya back to the world map and take its rightful place. So today we'll be marking a journey of commitment, the eagerness among Kenyans that these leaders pull together to save the country from the charge that is the Jubilee regime. And I can confirm that today marks the beginning of a very critical journey that will herald a new government come the 8th of August. We have no doubt in our mind that the roadmap we unveil from here today will culminate in a massive victory come the general election. So we'll sign this document today and then present and deposit it with the Register of Political Parties as required under the law. And then the principals will be able to provide direction on the next course of action, including our planned action. Remember that
the principles in that particular coalition, some were short-changed. This time round, what are Kenyans expected to see during this signing of this deal? Will it be made public?
I think one of the things you need to appreciate is that the coalition that is being put into place today is just an improvement of the code coalition. And you remember that even after the election debacle in 2013, we have done something that has not happened in any other democracy, running an opposition coalition. So our principles are not just brought together by the desire to win power. They have ideological unity. They have a like mind in terms of where they want to take this country. So what we are seeing here today is not an agreement between individuals. It is a collective commitment by the principals to provide this country with alternative leadership that it deserves. So the question of being shortchanged or being given a position that somebody didn't deserve does not arise, because our commitment is to take Kenya back to where it belongs. So that question does not arise, and I think we have demonstrated our unity of purpose even while we have been in the opposition. Despite the many mechanizations by government, they were not able to break us. And we can confirm that it will take something heavenly to break up this coalition. It's a commitment that is going to take this country for so many years. And we have our own internal mechanisms of how we want to manage the affairs of the coalition to ensure that it delivers to Kenyans what is contained in its manifesto.
The question begging out there among Kenyans, I think they are keen to know, will we today know the flag bearer for NASA as we head to the August polls?
Today we launch the framework that takes us to arriving at a flag bearer. You cannot have a flag bearer without structures. So we first have to establish and put in place structures, put in place a framework that defines how we arrive at our flag bearer. And discussions are at a very advanced stage. The principals have bonded enough for the last 4 years. I have always said, and I want to repeat again, that the question of arriving at a flag bearer within the National Super Alliance is the easiest question that will be dispensed with. It is only a question of when, and that moment is coming.
Looking at it, there was talk that we might have a public rally after the signing agreement here, but will we still have a public rally? And if not, maybe what has informed the decision to cancel that particular rally?
It's not a question of cancellation. It's a question of adjustment of strategy, and the principals will be able to provide direction when this rally is going to take place for strategic purposes. Yes. So it's not a question of a rally being cancelled. It's a question of adjusting strategy. Yeah.
Thank you so much. You've heard it from the Norman Magai, who is the Chief Executive Officer of the NASA Coalition. As the leaders, we wait their leaders to come here and sign the agreement on a power-sharing formula. There are many issues, as he did indicate, that will be outstanding. Something to do with the economic recovery strategy. They're going to discuss maybe on how to manage public debt. There are also the issue of joint nominations for the parties. There are those areas that maybe parties, where they perceive that they enjoy majority support, maybe those areas will the parties that are perceived to enjoy popularity will field a single candidate. But in areas where there is a possibility of fielding more than maybe parties don't enjoy that dominance, then they will witness joint nominations taking place. Those are the talks that will carry on after the leaders sign this particular power sharing arrangement as we head towards the polls. And also the opposition, as it moves ahead to see whether it will be able to form the next government after the August 8th polls. To the studio.
All right, many thanks, Patrick and Mimo. They are joining us live from Lavington, where NASA is expected to sign a deal on their power sharing to bottle it out with Jubilee in the August 8th general election. In the studio with us, we have Professor Michael Onaina and political analyst Martin Ndati. Just final closing comments. We've seen Norman Magai there clear up some speculation that we will not be hearing or finding out who the flag bearer is just yet.
Yes. Michelle, if you didn't believe me when I told you that I'm not expecting anything, there is your answer. That don't hold your breath. Mm-hmm. I don't think there's going to be anything earth-shattering that is going to come out of the so-called signing. Mm-hmm. The speculation will continue.
It will continue. And Ati?
I think what they are trying to do is to create, keep the suspense. But, you know, suspense is good if it is in a movie. But in real life, it's not very helpful. Uh-huh. So the earlier they unveil the candidate and start handling fallouts, if any, and psychologically preparing their supporters, the better. Uh-huh. Because you see, Kalonzo has been very adamant that he needs to be the candidate. The Western Bloc has Musalia and Wetangula there. So they are also anxiously waiting, hoping that one of them will land the ticket. Then those who believe in what they call the reform, they say if Raila is not the candidate, they have no business. So, you know, you have got to try and manage all those expectations. Of course, he's talking about ideology, but I don't think there are issues of ideology here. Mm-hmm. Because you saw Musalia was Uhuru's running mate in 2002. Ruto was with Raila in the other dispensation. Mm-hmm. So where is this ideology, you know? Kalonzo is now here. The other time, the two who are in power had called Musalia to be their candidate. Mm-hmm. So which is this ideology which keeps on changing every other day?
Right, so
it's about selfish getting power, you know,
yeah.
And locating the other guys.
What is in it for the Kenyans,
yes,
and the citizens? That is a conversation that will continue later on. Professor Michael Wanaina and Martin Ndati will be joining Betty Kyalo on News Center at 10 a.m. Now,